1 Corinthians 12, 18. But now, when? Now. Hath God set, who set? God's setting something, isn't he? Now he's doing it. The members, that's us. Everyone, no, that's just for pastor. I'm just like low man on the totem pole. I got saved 3 weeks ago. That's just for them super saints. I don't see any clause in there that says that. You need to be going so you can be growing. You're only limited by what you're able to manage at this point, but that can change. But you're in every one. Every one of them in the body. What body? The body of Christ, his bride, the church. As it hath pleased him. I don't like my life. You're bucking against God Almighty. As it pleased him. I don't like my skill sets, my giftings. I don't like where I am. I don't like what I'm doing. Pleased him. It's the vessel looking back at the potter and saying, you messed up. I know you claim to be a master potter, but look what you did with me. We're going to counter all this in the core. Because what has been going on in your life and around your life is not a part of his divine design. So don't blame him for you getting off course. Because he set everyone in the body as it has pleased him. So when we go through this series, you're going to see just how important you really are. Are you willing to go on a journey with me? Amen. Let's go. Father, in Jesus' name, thank you for the reading of your word. Thank you that if you be for us, who can be against us? That, Lord, you have a purpose and a place for every single one of your children. Lord, you said you created everything for your good pleasure. It was your pleasure for us to be here, and it pleased you to design us the way you did. That pleased you. And it's impossible to please you without faith. We need to have faith in you again that we're not a mistake and embrace what you have created us to be. Whew, I felt that, guys. I felt that. Thank you, Holy Spirit. I felt that one. Amen. We love you, Lord Jesus. Be magnified in this place. And all God's children said, amen. Look at your neighbor on the left and say, hold on. Look at the one across the aisle and say, get ready, because here it comes. Let's throw up Jeremiah 1, 4 through 5. Everything's going to be scripture-based out here, but I'm going to let loose and shoot off here in just a little bit. I want to get some scriptural precedent here. Jeremiah chapter 1, verses 4 through 5. Then the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee. Oh, I love this for pro-life statements. Amen. He saw. It's not just God can just see in the future. God's already been in the future. That's why he knows the end from the beginning. It's not that he can just see it afar off because he's God and he's got better eyes than an eagle. It's because he's already been there and he knows everything. That's why he can walk it back to try to get you on course, because he sees the finished product. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah, Jesus. And before thou camest forth out of the womb, listen, I sanctified. In other words, I set you apart. I have a specific purpose in mind for you. Now, you can go off and do your own thing. And I'm going to be a little bit hard here, okay? I'll just be honest with you. You can do what mama tells you you're supposed to do in life. You can take 100% advice from your guidance counselor before you get out of high school. Or you can make it on to college and get kind of a guidance thing going on based on your testing skill sets. Or you can go to your designer. Because when something goes wrong with a product, you always want to go back to the owner's manual. And if we're not going back to the owner's manual, listen, you may miss it. Because if you're not spirit-led, you will be misled. Are you really being spirit-led, or is it just you have heard dad was a doctor, grandpa was a doctor, so I'm just going to be a doctor? Is that what God said, or is that just the family tradition? Amen or oh me or something. Glory be to God. He sanctified you. And parents, I can't just leave that alone. You need to be asking God for you to show you about your kids so you're not just going on your personal preferences or opinions. Parents, I got to hit this. Man, this is going to take longer than I ever thought. Glory be to God. Because you want the best for your kids too. God may want them to go into the educational system and be a third grade teacher. But because they scored extremely high on their ACTs, because they've gotten certain colleges looking at them and getting some scholarships, you want them to go into psychology. And you're looking at the pros and cons, and let's be honest, basically you're looking at their yearly wage. Where they're going to make, I don't even know how much they make in the school system these days, I don't know. X amount. And then you go over here and, oh, well, this is, you know, a private practice. Higher degree. Oh, you'll be raking in the dough over here. And so you push them towards financial. Nobody wants your kid to be broke, busted, and disgusted. But even though they're in psychology, eventually they're going to have to sit in their own couch. Because I get them all the time. When they're 18 years old, you can shoot for the moon. Set the bar high, youngster. Get them, whippersnapper. We're all behind you. And then they get 35 years old, married for 10 years and got two kids. Live in a nice house, got a car paid for, and you know what? They're miserable. Pastor, I don't know what's going on in my life. I just don't know. Just not happy. Just not happy. And you were, instead of purpose-driven, you were prosperity-driven. Not knowing that your true prosperity is always tied in your purpose. Because there's something a lot more valuable than money. But I'm here to tell you, because man of God I highly respect told a story one time that has stuck with me from day one. That God called this guy to be a janitor. And he was a janitor at a airport. And he did his job and didn't mind. Listen, he liked his job where a lot of other people would look down and frown or something. He liked his job. And since he worked in certain sides of the airport, he would work where all the people that got on private jets were going back and forth. All the CEOs and the chairmen of the boards And they all kind of got together and kind of met at one place one time where there's a few people that kind of knew him. They knew the janitor. And they were at an uppity place. restaurant. I believe the story's right. The location may be changed, but this sounds good, so I'm going to roll with it. Amen. At least I'm going to be honest with you, because I've heard so many stories over the years. But the principle's going to be, I'm going to get the principle right. But anyways, he had something of value, and I can't forget if it's a car or something like that, and they were shocked. How in the world can you have that on that kind of a salary? I know they ain't paying you to, you know, do that. Are you just that poor money management? In other words, you just trying to be ghetto fabulous? And you know, you can't even buy a McDonald's French fry because you got to make that payment. See how they all of a sudden assume things from their perspective just because of what he was doing? But he said, oh no, this is paid for. Why, somebody give it to you? Yeah, my daddy gave it to me. My heavenly father. Well, how did that happen? Oh, you know, I'm just to let you know a little bit about me. I'm here because I actually like to do this. I enjoy this. But I got a little hobby on the side. You see, I've been good with the stock market since the time I was a teenager. And I've learned a little something over the years. And he had just as much money as some of them people stepping in and out of that plane. But that's just what he wanted to do. Because it was in him. And God used him as a vessel, listen, to pierce the heart of many people. Don't be looking at just dollar signs. God has a way of blessing you from the north, south, east, and the west. You don't go in it for the income, you get in it for the outcome. You get it to be a fulfillment. So I'm telling you, the older I get, the more valuable peace is to me. And not to totally quote a Southern rock song, but a simple kind of man. That I know even as this church multiplies and grows and we are outreaching in this region. I saw a regional church from the beginning. I don't know about national or international, but I know it's going to be a regional church. That I know that there's going to be things that are going to increase in my life. So I'm already at this point trying to get my, when I don't have the mic in my hand and I'm not showing up to the office, how can I make my life more simplistic? Because that peace is valuable. And if you're in your purpose, you're going to have that peace. Amen. Are you following with me? Let's go to Romans 1:17. Is this helping anybody already? Romans 1:17. For therein is the righteousness, the rightness of God revealed. How is the rightness of God revealed? I need some revealing in my life, God. I need your rightness because you know what? I feel like I'm on the wrong path. I need the right path. I ain't got time to play games no more. I'm not 17 no more. What's the right path, God? Well, therein is the rightness of God revealed. Listen, from faith to faith. See, what we want to do is we want to take that first faith and then the two out of there and just from faith, just one faith and that's it. I'm going to get on my knees. I might even fast for a few days. I'm going to get a hallelujah moment and we good for the rest of my life. But the word says that his word is a lamp unto your feet. He didn't say it's a highway patrol mag light that can shoot down the highway about a mile. It's a lamp. In other words, you can see your next step. And he designed it that way. I'm not going to show you steps 2, 3, and 4. I'm going to show you step 1. Will you take it? And will you trust me that the one after that's not going to be a cliff? Because we can drop the lamp, which is the word of God, and just try to go our own way, and then we will. We'll stumble and fall, bump our toes and fall off cliffs, hit briar patches, maybe even step into a bear trap. Who knows? But as long as you've got that in front of your feet, you can see your next step. So the right way of God is from faith to faith. Saying it like this, from step to step. As much as we shout about this in church, and I've been guilty about saying it before, there's no scripture that I have read where it says anything about taking a leap of faith. It's always steps of faith. We say that, well, I'm going to just take a leap of faith, brother. Well, we understand what you're saying, but if you really want to get scripturally sound on that, you're taking a step of faith. And so, the rightness of God, the righteousness of God is revealed to you step by step, by step, by step. And through this series, we're going to talk about these different steps because everybody in this room is at a different place in a different stage. But the similarity is that we've all left something and we have something that we're going to. And even though the navigation may be a little different between us, the same principles will remain intact. And so that's what we're going to do as we go over these principles. Because the core is about you living your life according to your divine design. Is what this whole series is going to be about, even though we'll take offshoots on different weeks and different areas. It's about you living according to your divine design and having fulfillment. You can have success and you can have achievement, but that doesn't mean that you have fulfillment. Hence the facts of how many multimillionaire, famous people and people of reputation and wealth have committed suicide. Oh, that ain't for just the trailer parks and the ghettos. Unfulfilled's unfulfilled. Whether you're driving a 1983 Pinto, and I don't know, did they make him a 1983? Some car buffs might call me on the carpet about that. So let's just say Pinto. How about that? Whether you're driving a Pinto that's got more Bondo so it can keep you to go. Or whether you're rolling up in the latest Lexus hybrid. Unfulfillment can affect us all. And as we're going to dive into this deeper, we're members set in the body. Not everybody can be a nose. Not everybody can be a ear. Not everybody can be a knuckle. Not everybody can be an ankle. But he set you there because it pleased him. What if you quit acting like an ear because you're a nose and start glorifying him that you're a nose and have faith in it? Because it pleased him for you to be that. And don't you think it'd be like an extra dose, like the sprinkles on top? Like you're not done at Marble Slab until you get your sprinkles, right? But I want that, that, and that. Oh, and the sprinkles. How much it would bless him back if you're like, yes, it pleases me too, Father. Have you ever, I hope you haven't had one, I hope you only know of one. Have you ever known of a kid that wanted something for Christmas and their parents worked overtime for months just to be able to get them something that they wanted? And they open it up, and they're like, I wanted the red one. I didn't want the green one. I just moved to the next present. And you're thinking about all them hours you put into overtime, and you love your kid, but the spirit of slap is rising up in full force. Like the high tide coming in Ain't nothing gonna stop it. And how many things, not only just the hours that you put in extra, the effects on your body, the putting up, especially if you don't have a nice boss, all the extra stuff you got to put up with there, the time away from your family. And I'm not wondering, just wondering if God feels the same way when we start bucking about what He's designed us to be, because it pleased Him. And we're just like that kid and wonder, I don't want to be the ear or the nose. I can't. I be a cheekbone. I don't like it. And here's what we do in life. I'm going to talk to the hand. I'm going to go to a plastic surgeon. You will listen. You will never be what you're pursuing to be outside of Him. You will never be. Are you hearing me? For those watching that are totally confused about your gender, if you have seed, you're a man. If you have a womb, you're a woman. I don't care what you do on the outside. I don't care how much surgery you have. You're never going to be what you're confused about wanting to be. It pleased Him to set you in the body. Was that too strong, or can we move on? To find your core, you have to use your sixth sense. Wait a minute, Pastor. Let me make sure that I heard that right, because we have five senses. Well, maybe that's where you're at, because you don't realize you got six. You have to use your sixth sense, which is your spirit. See, I heard a story told. It was for another application, but it's applicable here. Where if you're out on a boat on the lake, we're talking about freshwater fishing now. We're not talking about being 90 miles offshore and trying to land a grouper or amberjack. Freshwater fishing. And that you can try this lure and that lure, but if you want to get a bass and nothing else works, you can always pull out the purple worm. No matter what's going on, they will hit the purple worm. So you always keep that in your arsenal. Because if this doesn't work in that, this will get them every time, the purple worm. Can't resist the purple worm. And the enemy knows that about your life too. I can't get him on this and that and the other, he'll call his minions up and say, get out the purple worm. You know they can't resist that purple worm. We got him in 95 with it. We got him in 2001. Got him twice in 2006. Get out the purple worm. And that fish goes up to it and is like, it looks good, smells good. Might brush up against it. Feels good. Swimming right along. Sounds good. Let me see what it tastes like. And the reason that they got hooked is because they only have five senses. But God has instilled in all of His children, all of His children, a sixth sense, which is the Holy Spirit that resides on the inside of our born again, perfect, going to be the same way billions of years from now, Spirit. And when you quit operating on the outside and you start operating on the inside, it doesn't matter what dangles in front of you, because listen, you no longer see the worm, you can see the hook. Superman has nothing on God's children. He's given us the X-ray vision. His vision, who knows all, sees all. We have to use our sixth sense. Glory be to God, if we want to find our core. Give you an example. Well, he looks good. Oh, he feels good. Them strong arms. Oh, he sounds good.
You want to go out tonight, baby?
And he has a six-pack. He has all that. He's got a six-pack, but no diploma. He can hold you in his massive arms, but can't hold down a job. He's so good looking, he's a 10. Oh, yeah. The same number as his credit score and IQ. And he may have plans for you tonight, but he doesn't have a 5-year plan for anything. He's a priority in your life, but you're an option in his. Oh, it feels so right when we're together. Twice a month, which is oddly strange because he still lives at home and plays video games all day. So he can only be with me twice a month. But never mind that. His gorgeous eyes are so captivating. I thought that would go over about like that. I was ready for you. If you used your sixth sense, your spiritual discernment, you could see right through that joker in a New York minute. But if you want to be led anything else but the Spirit, you're going to be misled. And you'll show up and want to talk. Pastor, can I talk to you today? Why didn't you let me talk to you for this next 6, 7, 8 weeks? Where was you then? Praise God, he has mercy. I don't have as much mercy as God does. Can I talk to you about that? Oh, yeah, that was that message series. Go back and watch it. You don't need to counsel with me. I got 5 hours worth of materials on that. Go ahead and do it. Take notes and then come back to me and read me your notes, and then we can talk about some of that stuff. I'm not going to spend 5 hours with you when I spend an hour every week with everybody else. Why do you deserve that special kind of treatment to get 5 hours of my time? Everybody say, thank you, Jesus, for Pastor Kimberly. Because she'll sit there with 5 hours for you. She'll do. She'll get out her notes from sitting in here, and he'll go over the whole thing. Well, if he won't, I will. I'll be your friend. Amen. I love my wife. I love my wife. But in using that example, listen, we're not talking about someone who's starting from a menial position. Let's clear the air about that in case that gets cut, sliced, and chopped and somebody who's a hater wants to, like, throw me under the bus on that. Let's balance that out for those who will listen to the whole counsel here. We're not talking about somebody who's just starting out from a menial position. We're talking about someone who wants to stay there. Yeah, because of where he was grown up, because of what he didn't get. That's all he knows. That's the best he could do. Maybe you were sent into his life to help him with some etiquette. Because you can still have a 4-year degree and still not know how to act professional. That when you get around your peers, and you got your degree and you're in this business and you're around your peers, you kind of timid going into the room and you realize, I really don't fit in here yet. I'm not carrying myself the way I do. I don't have the certain kind of things that, you know, they're bringing in there. They're bringing out their briefcase. They got this, that. I don't even know why they got that there for. Do I need that? I studied hard. I passed. But now I am thrusted into an environment that I'm unaware of. I have no experience in. I've got the degree, but I don't have the experience. I don't have the background. And maybe you're sent in that person's life to help them in these areas. So we're not throwing anybody under the bus who didn't have an opportunity to start at the same place you did. So let's clarify that. It's not the person. We're not talking about somebody who's starting from menial. We're talking about somebody who wants to stay there. It's not where they start. It's where they want to stay. They want to stay there. They want to stay there emotionally. 28 years old, still lives at home. And if he don't get his way, he throws a fit just like a 7-year-old. And you try to reason with him, and it's like there's just like a blank look. He ain't listened to a word you're saying. You might as well be Charlie Brown's teacher. Wah, 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 wah. Just like if you ever try to tell a 7-year-old that they can't go to the park because something might have been going on or something real important, they ain't listened to anything that you say, but all they want to hear is, I can go to the park. I can go to the park. That's all they want to hear. And since they're not hearing what they want to hear, they're not listening to anything else. And so they're still a child emotionally. They're still a child relationally. They don't understand about relationships. Give and take and compromise and withdrawals and deposits. Because they just want to stay there. And they want to stay there financially too. Amen. So whether we say instinct, whether we say inclination, whether we say intuition or proclivity, listen, it all means living from your heart and not your head. So you can be spirit-led. Throw up 1 John 2:20. Now, if you're going to believe John 3:16, you can't say that you're not going to believe this one. It's from the same Bible. Don't be pickers and choosers. But you, are you born again? Then this is you. It kind of reminds me of... This is a good place to put a plug into that. I got blessed a few days ago with a new car, and I don't have a clue about some of the bells and whistles. I don't know. You can do that, Pastor, with that car. Great. You want to show me how to do it? Did you realize that, you know, you can do this or that or another? Nope, never had a clue. Tell me more about that. What good is it to have it if you don't even know what to do with it, or even worse yet, it's there, but you don't even know it. I wonder how many of us have had something on the inside of us all of our life since, even, and we're going to get into this too, even before we got born again. Hello. Because God always put something in us, His divine design. And we've never known it. It's not that we passed the opportunity by. It's that we were so oblivious with our life and the surrounding world and culture or family and the pressures of life all around us. It's not that we just missed the opportunity, that it walked right past us and we never even recognized it. Like, I'm on the fence about this. I don't know if I want to do this or not. And somebody's about to help you out big time. Somebody is getting out of what you want to get into. And you back off from it because you really don't know if you want to go there or not. And that was an opportunity. And they say that you got to take an opportunity of a lifetime in the lifetime of the opportunity. Because it's being given away, somebody's going to get it. They got your blessing. That was your opportunity. I thought God was the God of second and third chances. He is. But sit down, honey, because the cycle's got to go around. It's going to be a while, but it will come back around again. I don't want it to. Well, you had your chance. So sit down. Get comfortable. Learn from it. And wait. Oh, that's a four-letter word in this society, isn't it? Everybody wants a microwave, and God says, I still operate on a crock pot. And for you younger kids in here, I ask your parents, grandparents, what in the world I just said. And you're not changing his way of doing things. And he gave you, and he was faithful. Faithful is he who calls you, who also will do it. He was faithful, and he did it, and you didn't even recognize it, or you botched it. Don't blame God. You know, I see it a lot of times in some of the drug and rehabilitation centers that we go into, where there's things that are set up, and they're provided, and they're down, and they're out, and the ones that really won't help, you know, they stand out. I've done it for so many years. You know, the ones that have to be there, the ones that are tolerating to be there, and the ones that I don't never want to go back again. What have I got to do to never come back here again? And they get help from so many people and from so many places. And but it's kind of like, thank you, Holy Spirit, it's kind of like losing a loved one. Everybody calls you for 2 weeks, and then it's like, where did that go? Well, I got all this help and support from people, but now where are they at? I'm still lonely. You said you would kind of help me, but now that I'm out and I'm trying to do things on my own, I don't look around and I don't have a cheerleading section now. And if you don't follow through with them opportunities, you'll find yourself maybe in the back. And I see it. It's funny. It's almost like a circuit. I won't see them in here because they graduated, but I see them in this one. And then a year later, I'll see them in this one over here. And then, and there's opportunities missed every time. They get out and get on their feet, and all of a sudden, they want to just stumble right back into the same ditch they fell into. See, God, and this is, I know this has been controversial. Somebody will take me to task on this, but that's all right. God can set you free, but he can't keep you free. He can open those prison bars and get you out. But the minute you want to walk right back in, you can. Scripture says that when the devil's went out of somebody, that if it's swept and clean, in other words, if you leave it empty and don't fill it up, there'll be seven more just like it. And I'm just here to tell you that the more you do that, this is why there's such a high unsuccess rate. This is why a lot of people don't even want to get involved with addicts and ministries. Because the truth is that once you've missed it three or four times, you thought you fell, you know, I want to go rehab because I fell all the way to the bottom. You didn't realize that ain't the bottom yet. About your fifth time, that's about the bottom. And every time it happens, every time that you stumble, fall, you miss the opportunities, it's that much harder. And most people get in those situations, unfortunately, because there's not a lot of guts, gusto, determination, diligence. I mean, I know heathens that can just come to their senses and say, I'm not doing that crazy stuff no more. You don't have to have wild Holy Ghost to realize this is going to take my, I am my own worst enemy. And each time it happens, worse and worse and worse and worse. And that's why I'm trying to ring a bell in here over this series, The Core. The divine design is for us. The opportunities will be there. But are you so fixated on your way of seeing your life that you won't look through the Lord's lens to see you for who you really are? You can't have a jersey with your name on it because you're always wearing everybody else's. You believe in them, but you don't believe in you. But yet God Almighty believes in you. We're going to have transformational thinking through this series. But you have an unction. That means anointing. You have an anointing. I know in certain circles you hear that, you hear anointing so much that it kind of loses its purpose and power and almost sounds like a catchphrase. An anointing, listen, I'm just going to break it down. An anointing is an appointing with empowerment. That's all it is. I called you to do this, and I'm going to put my hand on it. And it says, we have this an anointing. Why? Because we never missed a day in Sunday school, and we got a star for every year that we went to Sunday school when we was a kid. No, you have an anointing from the Holy One. I'm going to have to stop it here or I'll just keep going on and on and on and on. And you, wait a minute, he ain't talking to me, I know, because I have no clue what I'm supposed to be doing. I don't have a clue what my purpose is. I don't have a clue what I'm going to do next month. 5-year plan? I don't think so. I'd like to have a 5-month plan. I don't know. What direction should I go in? Should I sit? Should I stand? Should I walk? Should I run? Is this a time of preparation? Or is this a... He ain't talking to me. And we'll hold on to that and we'll let go of, and you know all things. So who are you going to put your confidence in? Your experiences, your choices, the counsel of men, the opinion of Facebook? Oh, you'd be surprised. Why in the world you did that? Well, everybody said. What do you mean everybody said? What did your pastor say? I hadn't asked my pastor. Well, I know your uncle's a real good man. What did he say about it? I didn't ask him. Well, who in the world's everybody? Well, I put it out on Facebook, and 9 out of 10 people they recommended. You know all things because what you have is from the Holy One. And until you trust this verse and you trust what the Word of God says and trust that He has put that in you, you will always be misled because you're not being Spirit-led. Your core, who you are, your divine design. I'm praying. That's why I said I felt the weight of this when we got started. Because by the end of this series, I want you guys to be stronger than horseradish on the inside. Amen? I want you to be able to, what the Scripture says, to look at your mountain and say, grace, grace, be thou removed. I want you to be able to run through a troop and leap over a wall. Why? Because our eyes are open and our perspective is the lens of the Lord. And ye know all things. Does that mean I know everything God knows? That means you know everything that you need to know about your story. Let the author of your story walk you through See, it's easy to go back in Scripture and sometimes pick on the Israelites for things because we have a hindsight and we already read through it. Let's walk our story out. The book of Acts is not finished. It's everything that Jesus began to do, he's still doing. Stand to your feet. I hope this series will bless you tremendously. Stay with it. Stay with it.